I think it's time to start the first panel, Formen und Praxen radikaler Solidarität. My name is Tauno Saarela and I come from Helsinki, Finland, and trying to keep this session in order. So we are making a small change in the order of the panel. First, we have Jesper Jørgensen's presentation, and we are going to listen to these five presentations, and after that, comments, and after that, we have a general discussion, if we are lucky. So now the first paper will be presented by Jesper Jørgensen, who is working at the Workers' Museum and the Labour Movement's Library and Archives in Copenhagen, Denmark. And during the last years, he has been involved in a project dealing with Danish communists and their international files in the Comintern archives. And besides that, he has also been involved in editing a book about Danish Soviet relations and the involvement of Comintern in that. So now Jesper will present a paper, Radicalizing Solidarity, the Danish Social Democratic Youth League and IFSYPO, a very complicated something, from 1914 bis 1990. But I'm sure Jesper is going to tell us what this means. This.
Ich danke Ihnen für den begeisterten Empfang und hoffe, dass die Begeisterung nicht meiner Person gilt, sondern der Idee, für die wir kämpfen. Ich werde Ihren Gruß weiterbringen. Kopenhagen ist eine Stadt von großer Bedeutung für die Sozialdemokratie. Hier wurden 1910 der Internationale Kongress und der Kongress der Jugendinternationale abgehalten. Das war zu einer Zeit, als wir alle an die Sozialdemokratie glaubten, auf die Macht und Stärke der Internationale. Auch als der Gewitter vor dem Ausbruch stand, in den letzten Tagen vor dem Ausbruch des Krieges, hofften wir, dass sie imstande war, den Krieg zu verhindern. Unser Herzen glühte vor Freude, als wir von den 50.000 Arbeitern in Berlin hörten, die in Protest geschlossen durch die Stadt zogen, um gegen den Krieg zu demonstrieren. Und als wir erfuhren, dass die deutsche Sozialdemokratie einen Vertreter nach Frankreich entsendet hatte. Aber die Enttäuschung wurde nur umso größer, als die Heere gegeneinander zogen, als die Proletarier auf Proletarier zu schießen begannen. Those were the words of the International Secretary of the International Federation of Socialist Young People's Organizations, also known as the Youth International. His name was Wilhelm Willy Münzenberg, and the speech was delivered to the Copenhagen Young Socialists on May the 20th, 1917. and the young socialists in Copenhagen were indeed excited by the speech. According to the journal Fremad, the evening with Münchenberg was enthralling and unforgettable. The 150 people strong assembly glowed with enthusiasm and solidarity, and the red songs were sung with vigor like never before. In other words, Münchenberg poured petrol on a revolutionary fire that was already well underway under war and revolution. And there's no doubt that he was a key player in promoting radical solidarity among the young socialists during World War I, a process which would eventually tear the international socialist movement apart. Like many other socialist youth organizations, in 1919, the Danish Social Democratic Youth League followed Münchenberg into the communist movement, although historically its political position was that of a free and independent youth movement. In the following, I will try to explain how it happened. Confusion after the outbreak of the war was great. Most social democratic and labor organizations joined the parliamentary truce policy in their respective countries, and several months passed before the young socialists recovered from the shock and began to restore the communication lines of international solidarity. In the case of the young Danish socialists, virtually the entire national leadership and overall about 800 out of 6,000 members was called up to do national service in the so-called security force at the beginning of the war. Clearly, there was a good reason why it was only in late November 1914 that the issue of convening an international conference was raised in the Danish Social Democratic Youth League. It was decided that the chairman, Ernst Christiansen, should on the one hand contact the Norwegian and Swedish youth organizations, and on the other hand, the pre-war secretary of the Youth International, Robert Danneberg in Austria. Just before Christmas, Ernst Christiansen could inform the Youth League's executive committee that he had received only a cool response from Danneberg, while Norway and Sweden had responded in a much more positive way and had invited the Danish organization to attend a Scandinavian conference in Stockholm in late December, held at the same time as the Swedish Youth League's own congress. For this conference, the Danish chairman produced an anti-war resolution which had in advance been sent to but rejected by Danneberg. According to Danneberg, it would be a wrong move for the youth organizations to take a stance on the war without consulting their parent parties. And it would in any case be impossible for them to meet when the member countries were at war with each other. He announced, however, that the Swiss and Italian youth organizations were preparing a conference in Bern. Participating in the Bern conference in April 1915 were a total of 14 delegates from 10 countries, from Germany, Poland, Holland, Russia, Bulgaria, Italy, Norway, Sweden, Denmark, and Switzerland, as well as two representatives from respectively the Swiss Social Democratic Party and the Bernese Labour Movement. The German delegates represented the opposition in their organizations and were not formally recognized as delegates. Out of the three representatives from Russia and Poland, one was a Menshevik and two were Bolsheviks, all of them immigrants. Therefore, the neutral country delegates had the strongest mandate at the conference. However, three Italians never reached the conference as they were denied exit from Italy on the border to Switzerland. Instead, the very active Italian youth organization was represented by the Russian-Italian revolutionary Angelika Balabanov, who was already in Bern as a representative of the Russian Mensheviks to the Women's International Conference. She later became secretary to the International Socialist Commission, ISC, also known as the Zimmerwald Committee, and subsequently to the Comintern. Among the most important decision was the introduction of the annual anti-militaristic youth day. It was also agreed to move the secretariat to Zurich and to appoint the German refractaire Willy Münchenberg from the Swiss Youth as the new secretary. Moreover, it was decided to create a Liebknecht Foundation to finance the secretariat, and finally, the conference appointed a bureau to coordinate future activities. The bureau consisted of Münchenberg, the Danish chairman, and three others from Norway, Italy, and Germany. Indeed, the Bern Conference was in many ways a historic event, because it was not only the Scandinavian Young Socialists' first meeting with Münchenberg, it was also the Young Socialists, including Münchenberg's first meeting with Lenin. According to Angelika Balabanov's memoirs, Lenin sat at an adjacent cafe trying to pull the strings behind the scene. Ernst Christiansen and Willy Münchenberg developed a friendship of crucial importance during the war, even though they did not agree on everything. Münchenberg was the most radical of the two, and according to Christiansen, the influence of Lenin on Münchenberg was large and growing. This impression was confirmed when Christiansen had a meeting with Lenin in Moscow in 1918, and Lenin immediately asked about Münchenberg's well-being during his imprisonment in Switzerland. Over the next few years after the Bern Conference, the Youth Secretariat developed comprehensive activities, particularly the publication of the journal Jugend Internationale with Münchenberg as chief editor. The journal included several articles by later well-known communists, Lenin, Trotsky, Zinoviev, Karl Radek, Karl Liebknecht, and others, and essentially the journal backed the Bolshevik line of tactics. In 1918, it was banned by the Swiss authorities, but it was published again by Münchenberg in Berlin in the summer of 1919, and continued after the Youth International's fourth Congress in November 1919, as the Journal of the Communist Youth International. During the war, the Jugend Internationale was also published in a Scandinavian version. The goal of the successful Youth Days, as expressed in the first issue of Jugend Internationale, was to create strong relations between the different national youth organizations through joint and concerted actions, formulated as follows. Die Genossen in Kopenhagen, Christiania, Stockholm, Paris und Berlin sollen wissen, dass zu gleicher Zeit, als sie für den Frieden und den Sozialismus manifestieren, dasselbe getan wird von ihren Freunden in Amsterdam, Wien, Bern, Bukarest, Rom und anderen Städten. But it was hard work. Virtually illegal in the belligerent countries, the activists were often quickly drafted into the army with fatal consequences. In the same first issue of Jugend Internationale, Angelika Balabanov wrote an epic obituary on the Italian Youth Secretary Amadeo Catanese, being refused entry into Switzerland to participate in the Bern Conference and afterwards sent to the Italian Northeast Front, where he now had fallen for a cause he never believed in. It was also difficult to maintain contact between the youth organizations. The Zurich Secretariat was severely limited by difficulty of sending mail and to travel to especially the belligerent countries. The first bureau meeting of the Youth International held in Zurich in February 1916 clearly bore the imprint of this problem. Even the Danish youth organization was reluctant to send a representative to Switzerland, and according to the internal discussions, it would be totally out of the question to do so if the organization itself had to pay for the travel expenses. In the end, the Danish chairman Ernst Christiansen participated and again met with Münchenberg and the other bureau members. The agenda was lengthy. There was much to discuss, particularly noteworthy was once more, as has been the case in the first issue of Jugend Internationale, the early mourning of the Tapfern, Mitkämpfer und lieben Jungfreunden, who were killed in the capitalist war. The martyrs had clearly a central role to play in creating a strong transnational youth community. Münchenberg was not traveling a lot around Europe in the early days, or early years of the war. Not until May 1917 did he come to Scandinavia for the first time. In Stockholm, he chaired the second bureau meeting. No other continental Europeans participated. The Austrians, the Dutch, the Italians made several different excuses. On the other hand, in addition to the Scandinavians, a representative from the by now nearly independent Finland participated, and local Russian and Finnish comrades participated as guests. Münchenberg accounted for the Secretariat's work and reported on the progress of the organization. He also reported briefly on his participation in the Old Revolutionaries Zimmerwald Conference in September 1915 and the ISC Second Conference in Kiental in April 1916. On the return journey from Stockholm, Münchenberg traveled via Copenhagen together with the two Danish representatives, Ernst Christiansen and Sigvald Helberg, chief editor of the journal Fremad. Here, as mentioned in the beginning, he was received with great enthusiasm. In his speech to the Danish youth, Münchenberger on the one hand stressed the revolutionary currents that surged from St. Petersburg after the Russian February Revolution, bringing hope for peace and the victory of socialism. And on the other, the great sacrifices, especially made by the Italian and German comrades who were taking a courageous stand against violent oppression, repression, and prison sentences. The horrors of war and the various anti-war manifestations led the members of the Socialist Youth Organization towards an ever-increasing radicalization, rhetorically expressed through repetitive wording about the socialist revolution as a necessary alternative to bourgeois society. The statements were often formulated as a direct and indirect criticism aimed at their parent parties for supporting their country's governments in office. What hit the nail on the head concerning these radicalization and polarization processes was, of course, the Russian October Revolution, conclusively tearing the labor movement in two. The young people were forced to choose sides, and many of them chose the revolutionary side together with their friends in the international socialist movement. The development was formally marked by the decision taken by the majority of member organizations of the Fourth Congress of the Youth International in November 1919 to join the Comintern and to create the Communist Youth International. But it was not an easy choice. Especially the Danish young socialists felt that they were in a difficult position. An important factor in understanding the radicalization of the Danish socialist youth during the war is the significance of transnational networks. Besides the strong and friendly relationship that was built up with Münchenberg in Zurich, the Danes worked closely together with the Norwegian and Swedish sister organizations. The Scandinavians were represented on each other's congresses and bilateral meetings between Norway and Sweden and between Sweden and Denmark were organized. They arranged no less than six Scandinavian conferences, crowned by the above mentioned Congress in 1919. On the other hand, the Danish Youth League became associated to the ISC during the war. This led to serious disputes with the Danish Social Democratic Party because the party was absolutely opposed to the Zimmerwald movement. In September 1917, the Danish Youth League was represented at a Zimmerwald conference, the third conference in Stockholm for the first time. Likewise, the ISC was represented at the Scandinavian Youth Conferences, for example, the conference in late April 1917 in Copenhagen. All in all, where Seth Höglund and Balabanov participated. All in all, Balabanov seemed to act as ISC's confidential contact person to the Danes. She continuously wrote letters of a rather private nature to the leadership, and in December 1917, sent Sigvald Helberg on a mission to Great Britain to establish contacts to the English opponents of the war in the Independent Labour Party. and to Russian immigrants in London. To sum up, we can say that the Danish Social Democratic Youth League, transnational contacts in Scandinavia, in the Youth International by Willy Münchenberg, and in the Zimmerwald movement by Angelika Balabanov, constantly pushed the League to adopt a more radical revolutionary stand. Secondly, these relations intensified the differences with the parent party and increased the polarization within the youth organization. Radical solidarity with foreign revolutionaries did, however, not prove to be a lasting phenomenon in the Danish labor youth. In addition to this, the radicalization was primarily concentrated in Copenhagen. Large part of the youth organization outside the capital left after the split with the parent party. Within a few years, the youth organization lost the majority of its members, and the Communist Party's breakthrough was postponed to the time of the world crisis in 1932. However, there was no doubt that the Danish Social Democratic Youth League and the Youth International contributed to the communist movement with leading cadres in a significant way during the following years. Subsequently, however, many left its ranks again. In Denmark, the socialist youth leadership became the new communist leadership, but most of them broke with the communist movement in the late 20s and rejoined the Social Democratic Party. In the late 30s, even the Youth International's great organizer and radicalizer during and after World War I, Willy Münchenberg, gave up and broke with Stalin's type of Soviet communism. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesper. Our next speaker is Irina Gordeeva. She comes from Moscow. She works there at the Department of Medieval and Modern Russian History, Institute for History and Archives, Russian State University for the Humanities. And her interests have been concentrated on the history of communitarian movement in Russia. She has studied the Tolstoyan communitarians, but now she is getting closer to our days and is writing a book on the history of radical pacifist movement in Russia, from the Tolstoyans to the independent peace movement of the late Soviet period, and that includes, for instance, hippies, cosmopolitan scholars, and others. Irina.
Thank you very much for the invitation and the possibility to introduce the Russian radical pacifists as socialists. Excuse me, please, for my poor English. My presentation will be follow my speech, so you can be easier to understand me. This paper is a part of my research on the history of the radical pacifist movement in Russia in the 20th century. It focuses on the attempt of the Russian radical pacifists to develop a transnational solidarity network around the idea of a nonviolent revolution. The Russian radical pacifist movement emerged at the end of the 19th century as a result of a public identification of the so-called Tolstoyans, the disciples of the Russian writer and thinker Leo Tolstoy. During that time, some of them traded the earlier ideal of self-perfection within escapist agricultural communities for the public activity. From the very beginning, the Tolstoyans' public movement had a definite identity as a radical pacifist, Christian socialist, and anarchist movement. The main values were nonviolence, freedom of conscience, and social justice. They were active in defense of the conscientious objectors, human rights of the religious minorities and other oppressed people. They struggled against militarization of society and all kinds of social and political violence. Despite the fact that the leaders of the radical pacifist movement in Russia came mainly from the privileged circles, the movement was geared toward the ordinary people, namely the religious sectarians, peasants, and workers. The Tolstoyans aimed to transform spontaneous folk practices of passive resistance and non-cooperation, so-called weapon of the weak, into the modern ethical and effective methods of social protest against the state, official church, and war. Between 1909 and 1928, the main base of the Russian radical pacifists was at Moscow Vegetarian Society, which was a kind of an umbrella organization to bring together the pacifists and mobilize them for different activities. They reached the peak of their public success after the revolutions of 1917. At this time, the Tolstoyans created the Society of True Freedom in memory of Leo Tolstoy in Moscow and its numerous local branches, arranged several central regional periodicals, established the Interconfessional United Council of the Religious Communities, organized groups for the defense of the COs, and succeeded in raising public sympathy among ordinary people. After repressions started in the early 1920s, all the Tolstoyan societies and periodicals were closed, and the pacifists consolidated around the Moscow Vegetarian Society. This society, with its rather innocent title, became a center of self-organization and mutual support of all the adherents of nonviolence. The Moscow Vegetarian Society had a vegetarian refectory, library, information bureau, and a system of interest circles. It promoted public lectures and seminars, published articles and brochures, provided mutual aid, created a network of correspondents, worked with children and so on. Possibly its most dangerous activity was circulation of samizdat bulletins or letters of the Moscow Vegetarian Society, which were extremely critical towards the Bolsheviks' policy. The pacifist leaders were Vladimir Chertkov, Pavel Bierutkov, Ivan Trigubov, Ivan Gorbunov-Posadov, and Valentin Bulgakov. In the late 19th century, these Tolstoyans, with the wide international support, organized a relocation of Duhoborz to Canada. This and other joint activities created the network of international trust. The forced immigration of Chertkov and Bierutkov to Britain and Switzerland also played a significant part in developing a collaboration with foreign supporters. Chertkov and Bierutkov established a publishing house, actively promoted publications and translations of Tolstoy's works, lectured about Russian social movements, contributed to the foreign pacifist, socialist, and anarchist press, and participated in the ideological discussions. The international collaboration of the pacifists became more active during the First World War and had not stopped after the 1917 October Revolution to early 30s. In the beginning of the 20s, the Tolstoyans actively drew upon the international connections for the sake of famine relief. Also, together with the Red Cross, they worked to aid refugees and immigrants. The Tolstoyans made a great effort to create the organizational structures of international solidarity. In 1919, they established a special bureau for international contacts of the section of the Friends of Peace of the Moscow Vegetarian Society. This section was working on amassing information such as the news about peace and pacifist movements abroad, reference data on the people who had been injured for the idea of universal peace. it was also preceding a request for legal and financial help. There were also youth circles within the Tolstoyan societies and communities, which independently maintained contacts with foreign pacifist youth. The result was a massive international network of groups and personal connections, which provided the base for trust and solidarity. Soviet Tolstoyans took an active part in the War Resistance International and International Fellowship of Reconciliation, the largest international pacifist organizations. WRI organized in 1922, united the absolute pacifists and was committed to fight against racial, religious, class, and national prejudices, which were regarded as the roots of all wars in the society. The organization also aimed to create an international brotherhood of mutual solidarity. They were looking to create a new social order, which was to be based on a collective labor and to serve a common good. I4 was established in 1914 in Britain on the platform of Christian pacifism. After the First World War, I4 members concluded that the pacifists need to fight not only against wars, but also against the roots of all wars. They considered the current social structure, capitalism and imperialism, as the main roots of wars. Hence, they proclaimed the goal of radical revolution and asked for mutual association of the people of different nations and religions, as well as elimination of the reasons which initiate the existence of social disparity. In other words, the elimination of the private property and capitalist system. Both organizations defended the COs and other peace prisoners, including Soviet ones, developed humanitarian missions and other forms of international solidarity. The Soviet pacifists established unofficial branches of these organizations and tried to keep in contact with the European groups by correspondence. Their numbers were insignificant, but the participants included not only intellectuals, but also ordinary peasants from the Tolstoyan communities. For many years, they continued to exchange information with the foreign fellows and try to participate in the international anti-war and pacifist congresses. Several principal directions can be outlined in the activities within this network of international pacifist solidarity. Collaboration on the development of the theory and practice of pacifist movement, creation of the informational network of pacifist and other groups, support of international solidarity initiatives against wars, violence, and repressions, humanitarian missions during wars and other disasters, writing open letters in support of the persecuted peace and social activists. I would like to focus on the first of these aspects, on the attempt to create the network in support of the idea of nonviolent communism. The origins of this idea can be traced from the very beginning of the 20th century, when some Tolstoyans proclaimed the necessity of nonviolent revolution or revolution of brotherhood. Most of these people were socialists and anarchists. Therefore, they appreciated the social slogans of the Bolshevik Revolution, but could not agree with the repressive nature of the new regime and with the compulsory character of the Bolshevik communism. The Tolstoyans became very strong and open critics of the Bolsheviks' revolution, highlighting the lack of freedom in the Soviet Russia and the Bolsheviks' repressive attitude toward the ideological opponents and religious institutions. They differentiated between the nonviolent religious and the violent governmental socialisms and regarded themselves to be the genuine revolutionaries, the nonviolent revolutionaries of spirit. Their dream was to help the Russian revolution to evolve from the violent stage to a nonviolent one, or the true brotherhood, and initiate the same process in the rest of the world. This theoretical pursuits were accompanied by the organizational attempts. Disappointment in the Russian Revolution pushed the Tolstoyans to develop a transnational solidarity network around the idea of nonviolent communism. Looking to gain an international support for this idea, they corresponded with foreign activists, published legal and underground samizdat periodicals. This samizdat, all this contained the sections called Chronicle of the Movement, which informed Soviet pacifists about foreign pacifist news, announced events, conferences, actions of solidarity, supplied reference information and addresses for correspondence. The Tolstoyans also sent their papers abroad in order to maintain connections and inform their foreign counterparts about the real situation in the Soviet Russia, including repressions against the COs, sectarians, and other religious dissidents. The peak of the activity of the Russian pacifists was their attempt to organize the international movement for Christian communism. This organization was created in August 1926 in Oberammergau in Bavaria by some religious activists under the leadership of Czech writer and leader of the religious commune Jerusalem, Przemysl Peter, and emigrant Stoyan Valentin Bulgakov from Prague. 45 Christian pacifists from different countries joined them. This was an attempt to create an alternative to the violent Bolshevik revolution in the form of international nonviolent religious movement. The objectives of the new movement were outlined in its manifest. According to it, the violent revolutions were far from the true communistic ideals, so the followers of the Christian communism had to reject violence and to become ready to nonviolent spiritual revolution. The genuine fraternal communist formation can be successfully established only in the case if the people will be spiritually and mentally prepared for it. Hence, the main task of the Christian communist would be to contribute to a moral and spiritual revival of every single person as well as the society as a whole. The principles and program of the movement for Christian communism proclaimed the solidarity on the grounds of the belief in a brotherhood of all people, as well as the ideals of an internally free person attuned to the voice of his personal conscience, resistant to any kind of external pressure. It also expressed a belief in a communal life, social equality, civil rights, cooperation, global solidarity without borders, and universal peace. The leaders of the new movement published their bulletin and visited many places in Europe for public lectures. They especially hoped to influence the Soviet Russia with its sectarian and peasant masses. The ordinary Christian pacifist in Russia, Poland, West Belarus, Czechoslovakia, Bulgaria, Baltic states, and some other states of the Europe started to read, discuss, copy, translate, and distribute the materials of the movement. They activated the grassroots network of personal connections in order to promote the ideas of the Christian communism. The remarkable aspect of this movement was its social base. It consisted not only of the refined intellectuals, but also of a wide range of ordinary people who craved the solidarity with like-minded people in Russia and abroad. This was a kind of grassroots movement, a politics from below. Russian radical pacifists were convinced that the fate of the world depends on their own stance and actions. Thanks to the samizdat and private correspondence, ordinary pacifists obtained information about pacifist movement worldwide, corresponded with numerous pacifists from different countries, appealed with their open letters to Soviet authorities and foreign governments, as well as influential persons. Among their addresses were Gandhi, Raman Rala, Einstein, and so on. For example, one of the Tolstoyans from Ukraine, from Poltava, with 40 years of Tolstoyan experience, wrote his letters only to Hitler and Mussolini. The Tolstoyans' agricultural colonies also had international connections. They were in touch with foreign Christian and alternative communities, received the bulletins of War Resistance International and corresponded with independent religious pacifists. In the 1920s, early 30s, Russian pacifists aspired to participate in the international anti-war and pacifist congresses, but they were not permitted to go abroad. The repressions against the Tolstoyans movement started in the early 20s, became stronger in the late 20s, and totally destroyed it in the late 30s. The unique but almost totally forgotten experience of the international solidarity of the pacifist movement of the 20th century can be reconstructed with the help of numerous Tolstoyans archives of Moscow and St. Petersburg. Now, here I demonstrate the only two examples of such Tolstoyans fonds. All Tolstoyans fonds are very huge and totally unexplored. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Irina. Our next speaker is Jean-François Fayet. He comes from the University of Lausanne, Switzerland, and he has worked quite a lot around Soviet foreign policy, international communism, anti-communism, and his works include, for instance, the political biography on Karl Radek, and then he has also studied this All-Union Society for Cultural Relations with Foreign Countries, this VOX. But at the moment, he is working on a history of October commemorations, and I think that his presentation today is also related to that. It's hands off the USSR, Münzenberg, and the internationalization of the commemorations of the 10th anniversary of the October Revolution.
Thank you for the presentation and for the invitation. It's always a pleasure to be in Berlin. From 1918 onwards, the 7th of November was a day of celebration. Speeches, military parades, orderly marches, inauguration of public monuments and commemorative plaques, political festivals, mass spectacles and popular parties that united the people and the territories of the Soviet Union in celebration of October. Where are the first anniversaries had been celebrated modestly, almost quietly, the festivities in honor of the 10th anniversary represented a sort of apogee in the Soviet regime commemorative practices. This can be seen on three levels. Firstly, the massive scale of the shows, the long duration of the parades, and the range of entertainments on offer throughout the entire territory of the former Soviet Union. Secondly, the event had an impact due to the presence within the USSR of about 1,000 foreign delegates. Around 80% of them were workers. Apart from the trade union delegates and the representatives of the main factories, there were guests from the International Worker Relief, the International Red Aid, the cooperative movement, the peasant movement, representative of proletariat defense organization, proletarian sport association, proletarian cyclists, Esperantists, free thinkers, top collectors, and friends of the proletarian theater. The most important national delegation in terms of number were the German, British, French, and Czechoslovakian delegations. The other were mainly representative of the nationalist revolutionary movement of the oppressed and colonized countries. The Nehru family, Sun Yat-sen's widow, the Turkish foreign minister, representative from Nepal, Mongolia, Algeria, Mexico, Brazil, and Sierra Leone. Most of them had been invited by the League Against Colonial Oppression. Finally, there were the members of the Western progressive intelligentsia, such as the writer Henri Barbusse and Panait Istrati, the Japanese poet Uyaku Akita, and Gabrielle Duchesne of the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. Unlike the ambassadors, these representatives were far from being passive spectators. Invited as observers, they were expected to take side and then to commit themselves. They had a role to play in the October spectacle and its political purposes. The Soviets intended to show the world that the USSR was not isolated and that the international legitimacy extended beyond the limited gamut of its diplomatic relations. Thirdly, commemorative events were also held outside the Soviet Union, constituting another aspect of the internationalization of the commemoration. Huge meetings took place in Berlin, smaller ones in Hamburg, Cologne, and Frankfurt, and others in Paris, London, New York, with workers' banquets and projection of Soviet film. An exhibition with 15 pictures traveled across Europe and the Americas under the title 10 Years of Socialist Edification. In some countries, workers organized strikes as a show of solidarity with the Soviet working class. Everywhere and in every language, a cry was raised on the day of the 10th anniversary of the October Revolution, Ruki Proch at SSSR, Touche pas à l'URSS, ends of the USSR, end the Weg from Soviet Russland. My first point is entitled Soviet Commemorative Culture, Sovietskaya Praznitskaya Kultura, served Münzenberg style. The idea of internationalizing the commemoration of the 10th anniversary of the October Revolution came from Münzenberg, who presented it to the Agitprop Department of the Communist International in 1925. The aims of the action were the strengthening and expansion of the Macy's favorability towards the USSR, the intensification of the fight against the imperialist powers' belligerent propaganda, an explanation of the work accomplished over the past decade in the country of the revolution, and the deployment of the enthusiasm created in so doing to constitute an association of the friends of the Soviet Union. The objective and methods with a detailed schedule were all in place. Münzenberg reiterated his proposal to Bukharin in summer 26 and in a letter sent to Stalin in November the same year. The proposal was not completely lacking in self-interest. At this time, the Comintern Secretariat was discussing the international worker relief liquidation, or at least reduction. Relations were no less strained between Prometheus Film Verlag and Sofkino regarding the distribution of Soviet films abroad. Münzenberg therefore made frequent trips to Moscow to take part in meetings of the executive committee and those of the agitprop of the Comintern. His commemorative plan was also accompanied by a funding request of 10,000 gold rubles to be paid by the end of 1926. Münzenberg thus intended to profit for the occasion of the 10th anniversary to fund various activities of the international worker relief, in particular his anti-colonial conference project, the Brussels conference planned for February 1927. The choice of slogans was highly indicative of this wish to associate the October celebration with the anti-imperialist struggle. Nuremberg gradually replaced the slogan 10 years of Soviet Russia against the menacing war danger with against imperialist war, don't touch China and hands off the USSR. In Münzenberg's opinion, the Congress of Friends of the Soviet Union, which had to come at the end of the visit of the foreign delegation, was merely a kind of Brussels conference, but for Russia. Münzenberg's project arose concern among several Soviet authorities. The Russian communists were aware of the importance of the commemoration, this political will to remember, as an instrument for the implantation of a regime whose legitimacy was contested both domestically and abroad. They therefore began to construct a new collective memory, a red calendar, through the reordering of time around the regime's founding act, the Great Socialist Revolution of October. The 10th anniversary celebration were therefore the results of a marriage between Soviet commemorative culture and the propaganda techniques created by Münzenberg for the 1921 campaign to aid Hungary in Soviet Russia. Point two, Münzenberg's style of political marketing. Inviting foreign dignitaries to celebration of sovereignty is a tradition as old as diplomacy itself. However, assisted by the communist parties, the trade unions, and the mass organization of the Münzenberg networks, the Soviets took these traditions to a whole new level. Matters related to the composition, invitation, and funding of the delegation were officially entrusted to a commission made up of representatives of various institutions, the Foreign Relations Committee of the Trade Union, the All Union Society for Cultural Relations Abroad, the Communist Youth International, and the Comintern. However, as pointed out by the agitprop deal of Comintern, a large part of the campaign should be left up to the initiative of Münzenberg. According to the Celebration Commission, a foreign delegation should ideally be made up of 20% communist, 40% social democrat, and 40% without party affiliation. The invitations were given based on the theory of distance dreamt up by Münzenberg in a circular sent to the CPs. It's a quotation. To give this campaign for the sending of delegation to the USSR the broadest possible dimension, it is advisable for the first call, the first manifestation, to come from organizations, groups, people, and newspapers located as far as possible from the communist movement. Münzenberg also insisted somewhat on the coefficient of representativeness of the delegates, by how many people had they been elected in a factory containing how many workers. The clever percentage draft in advance for the composition of the delegation nonetheless proved to be difficult to maintain due to the large number of refusals, especially from socialists who feared expulsion of their organizations. The multitude of players involved in the invitation campaign on a global scale aroused a number of tensions. Most of them involve Münzenberg or his affiliates. For example, the Soviet trade unions accused Münzenberg of obtaining publicity at their expense because it was Münzenberg that issued the invitation and the Soviet trade unions that pay for everything. Kameneva, president of the Vox, accused Münzenberg of stealing her intellectuals.
For his part, Mützenberg complained about the lack of effort made by most of the communist organizations to mobilize beyond their own ranks. Most of the delegation made a stopover in Berlin, where Mützenberg's department and the Soviet consulate checked biographical details, supplied visa, and dealt with any last-minute problems. As soon as they crossed the border, the delegates were under the full responsibility of the Soviet. The delegation's two-week stay was not a pleasure trip. They had not come as tourists, but to work, to investigate from Arkhangelsk to Yerevan, passing through Kharkov. Convinced that why they are seen, they decided, as expected, it was the project of Mützenberg, to take part by constituting on the 10th of November a Congress of Witnesses known as the First Friends of the Soviet Union Congress. Although it was apparently not present at the founding Congress, Mützenberg contributed actively to the international structuring of this new front. Third and last point, the commemoration in Mützenberg media. For an entire year, Mützenberg cranked up his media apparatus to celebrate the USSR 10th anniversary. First came the commemorative publications. The most famous was the German edition of the Illustrierte Geschichte der Russischen Revolution. The text came out in May 1927 in the form of 40-page booklets and then in a book of one volume. Mützenberg also took charge of the German edition of 60-page brochure presenting the result obtained in the USSR on almost every subject after 10 years. Mützenberg profited most of all from subsidies supplied by Moscow for the commemorative to increase the frequency and the circulation of the existing titles at Arbeiter Illustrierte Zeitung, this is the same too with Die Welt am Abend. Finally, Mützenberg used the circumstances of the campaign to create new titles such as Der Arbeiter Photograph. In addition to his own titles, all the international communist press and the so-called non-party newspapers had to follow the 10th anniversary publication plan proposed by Mützenberg to the agitprop lead of the Comintern. The record is much more mixed in terms of commemorative film. Two films were to embody, yes, I will respect the time, I'm Swiss. Two films were to embody the 10th anniversary in black and white. The first was, of course, the famous October by Eisenstein. The second was a documentary entitled In the Land of Lenin, Stran Lenin, funded by the Soviet trade unions. But neither of these films was ready on time. And the problem was that the distribution of Soviet films, even old ones, particularly clashed with the new commercial ambitions of soft kino, which demanded, for example, $10,000 to the fall of the Romanov dynasty. Finally, Mützenberg mobilized the Aufbau Industrie und Handel Aktion Gesellschaft company to produce various commemorative items, commemorative postcards, slides for slideshow, and other commemorative trinkets. This marked the beginning of revolutionary merchandising. This, the revolution, had become a festival, a succession of commemorative festivals. Conclusion, the strange turning point. The success of the 10th anniversary of the October Revolution allowed Mützenberg to expand his international worker relief apparatus and his influence in Moscow and Berlin. But this grand celebration also coincided with the suppression of communist opposition. Excluded from the Central Committee of the Party, Trotsky and Zinoviev decided to come out from the shadows of the 7th of November by joining the demonstration in Moscow and in Leningrad with their own slogans. The oppositionists were intercepted by security thugs who tore down their banners. Fight and arrest ensued. Babette Gross and Willy Mützenberg attended one of these public demonstrations of opposition. Like most of the foreign communists, he would certainly have tasted very little of this emergence of discounted nuns in the highly policed era of the festivals. Behind its reassuring image as an assembly point around the regime, the celebration also served as a screen for the struggle against the enemy within. This is the strange turning point referred to by Victor Serge, even though, paradoxically, it happened under the gaze of almost 1,000 of foreign observers, including Mützenberg himself. Thank you.
Thank you, Jean-François. Our next presentation will deal with forms of solidarity and the case is female volunteers in the Spanish Civil War. The presentation was prepared together by Xenia Widmar-Horvath and August Lesnik, and it will be presented by Xenia Widmar-Horvath, who works as a professor of the sociology of culture at the University of Ljubljana, and she has been interested in European studies, identity, memory, post-socialism, and recently biography studies related to the historic sociological discussion of women's migration.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much to the organizers for allowing us to present our research in this forum. Thank you also to the translators for their hard work. I must assure you that I will not be reading the whole paper. Just a very brief note of how we came to this research. I myself am a sociologist, and 3 years ago I started a huge project, national project, on various women's migrant groups in the 19th and 20th century, Slovene women who traveled abroad across Europe but also beyond the borders of Europe. And my colleague, Professor August Lesnik, who is also my roommate at the faculty, he studied archives on the Spanish volunteers from Yugoslavia in Belgrade. And when discussing our research findings, we realized that we have a common topic which concerned memories of past solidarity, past motives of individuals and groups for going abroad and joining certain battles that were beyond national quest. So we ended up with this paper, but also this year, together with other colleagues, we started a 5-year national program on social contract of the 21st century, where the idea or the topic or the theme of solidarity bears a key relevance. So we want, or I want in this presentation, also introduce the question or the memory of Spanish volunteers, women volunteers, in relation to theoretization and conceptualization of solidarity in post-national, post-nationalist terms. So our research questions were, what can be a historical legacy of the Spanish volunteers? What is the historical value of the memory of the transnational solidarity? And I must add instantly, there is very little or perhaps even no memory, public memory in current context of the Spanish volunteers. But as a sociologist, I'm also wondering what's the theoretical challenge of this history, of this historical period. And we started with the main thesis that the memory of the Spanish Civil War contains the potential to become an important element of the late modern and post-national mobilization of the model of European solidarity. When we wrote this paper, of course, we were not faced with the crisis of refugees on the borders of the EU. So we hope that this can also contribute to reconsideration of what's happening in current contexts, political contexts. The memory of Spanish Civil War also represents an important alternative, we believe, to the ruling ideology of the post-humanitarian society of consumer egoism by bringing to the fore the emancipatory and freedom-loving ideational formation of international popular alliance. And we refer here to several theoretical works, which I will present in brief later on. Sorry. Our method in this project was to look into biographies and reconstruct with the help of narratology, that is a literary method, discursive method, reconstruct biographies of 16 women volunteers from Yugoslavia who joined volunteer forces. Then we used method of memory studies and memory testimonials and theoretical and conceptual backgrounds of gender studies, cosmopolitanism, and above all, sociology of nationalism and other studies of nationalism. What is the origin of origin of solidarity? Of course, solidarity itself has a long history, but multiple meanings and connotations. And when we today talk about solidarity, I would even think that there are some generational misunderstandings or conflicts in understanding what solidarity means. But just going through the basic literature, of course, it has a long tradition. The term itself, the politics of solidarity, has a long tradition. It can be linked to Christian origins of the idea of brotherhood, Greek idea of harmony, which is based on mutual support, mutual empathy, and citizen friendship. But of course, a modern term belongs to the Jacobinian revolution, which transforms the idea of brotherhood onto the notions of emancipation, equality, and egalitarianism. Late 19th century also moves the idea of brotherhood to international working class brotherhood. That's the legacy of Marxism. And in 20th century, we are witnessing transformation of solidarity into specific nationalist ideal. I'm referring here, I'm very grateful for the opening panel lecture on implied nationalism of solidarity, which of course is constructed, it's a historical legacy of specific processes, but as I will try to show today also, by no means solidarity is framed or limited to national communities, and I would also in this regard dispute that today we are talking about the crisis of solidarity precisely because we are facing a crisis of national identity, but a little bit of that later on. Two important theoretical sources and historical sources on which we can reconstruct modern notion or modern concept of solidarity. Already, of course, Adam Smith, in theory of moral sentiments, where he talks about identification, the capacity, the ability to identify with the other, the anonymous other, someone who we do not know, as an important aspect of becoming a moral person, becoming a person of moral authority. I would also refer to, I think, very important historian study by Lynn Hunt, Inventing Human Rights. She herself also indicates how the notion of solidarity in the 18th and 19th century is very much related to the capacity to identify with unknown people, even fictional people, characters in romances, in novels, etc., etc. So this is a modern tradition which is somehow related to the concept of identification with the other that we do not know. This modern legacy in the late 20th century has become questioned. Post-structuralism in particular has relied on the Enlightenment legacy of the capacity to identify with the other within myself. But this other within myself, as in Kristeva's work, is very much related to the other that is vulnerable, that is on the margins, that is disempowered, etc., etc. So this is basically cosmopolitan or Kristeva's cosmopolitan idea of solidarity, which derives is derived from this ability to identify with the vulnerable. I mentioned that there are many political commentators, but also authors, theoretical writers, who would see solidarity, the notion, the concept of solidarity as being in crisis today, especially because it seems to me that we have lost the common ground that is rooted in the idea of the national community that's homogeneous, that has unified cultural identity, etc., etc. I must refer here again to Adam Smith, but also to other authors who say that modern solidarity by no means was reserved or was constructed through the nationalist political agenda, but was very much related to colonial and imperial, again referring to the panel, to the opening lecture today. So solidarity that was created among members of the national community was very much dependent upon the imperial expansion and colonialism, which created the other as a base to the identification that spread the emotions of belonging, loyalty, and brotherly love within the national communities. And that was something that we find already in Adam Smith, who by no means idealized capitalism as being the most appropriate political and economic form of the nationhood, but rather already himself related it to colonialism. So in postmodern politics of solidarity, we would definitely have to search for relations to post-colonial modes of solidarity. And indeed, global solidarity today has many marks of colonial or many imprints of colonial reasoning and thinking. However, this thinking is very much governed by new technologies of market, global market, and media. So what we are witnessing today is a form of solidarity that's very much what Choluriaki calls ironic stand, ironic moral stand, meaning that we know that we cannot help, that we cannot change the causes of injustice. We donate, we do show compassion to the other, to the vulnerable, but in a way we're not entirely honest about it, but above all we are doing it for our own good, for our own moral gratification and reward. Excuse me. So Chuliriaki calls this marketization of charity. So we have new industries emerging on the notion of compassion and the ability to suffer with the others. But of course, the mobilization of our sentiment is very much market and economy related. And we, according to Chuliriaki, the Western viewers or the Western citizens are aware of this fact, and she calls this a post-human disposition. So it's a disposition that's in a way a disruptor in modern history of solidarity. However, I would return to the context of the European Union and argue that it is not just about global economy and mass media, but that the lost sense or the lost meaning of solidarity is very much a political consequence or a consequence of political elites that are currently running the Europeanization of societies, of the EU societies. Yes, before I will skip a little bit testimonies and come back to this later. Why it is important to return to the history of the 20th century and look into forms of solidarities that went beyond the national borders. The EU project, especially after 1989, is very much based on specific historical revisionism of totalitarianism of the 20th century and the totalitarian ideas or ideas that ended up in totalitarian regimes. This is not just part of the anti-communist sentiment that's spreading across former socialist countries, but I would say that with the resolution on totalitarianism accepted by the European Parliament, that we are witnessing this kind of revisionism across the EU. The most important aspect or side effect or collateral damage, to quote Bauman, of this revisionism is that we have lost in the process historical capacity to understand human dispositions and also modern human disposition, also postmodern human disposition. And it seems to me that this is very important when we try to teach citizenship and responsible forms of social contracts. Especially important is also that solidarity as it emerged or as it was practiced in the 20th century, early 20th century context is today very much repressed as a historical evidence because it is so frantically or so obsessively connected to ideological divides of the 20th century. So it is very much unpleasant burden, especially to anti-communist forces, to think of solidarity in connection to Communist Party. In this way, the whole legacy again is obscured or even dispossessed of the right to historical evidence. Now, very briefly, why it seems to me that Spanish women volunteers can bring another or a different angle to this kind of selective memorization of the 20th century. Very briefly, our sample is very small, but by reading biographies of these women, I must say that the burden the courage that took these women to go to abroad very much it cannot be measured in quantitative terms, but rather should be considered in other with other measurements. What is very important is all these women, as far as we know from the archives, were having different biographies. So there is very difficult, hard to find a single trait that would unite their social, intellectual, political, or cultural profile. They have different levels of the education. Some of them have PhDs, some of them are medical doctors, some of them don't have primary school, have not completed primary school education. Have come from different ethnic, national milieus, have different patterns of mobility, etc., etc. However, what does bring the testimonies together is a very basic human compassion or empathy and identification with the suffer of the Spanish people. And this identification is not framed by nationalist sentiment, but has very much global or cosmopolitan connotations. These are just two testimonies I will not read to you, but want to show them that that these testimonies can persuade us of the strength of the passion and compassion for the suffering of the other, that was not just based on imaginary identification, but was very much meant bodily involvement. These women actually risk their own lives, their own bodies. Yes, I'm coming to the conclusion. I would just perhaps underline the second line. How does one speak of the great love of certain generation from around the world? A love for peace, freedom, progressiveness, humanism, culture. So this is beyond just political ideology, beyond political mobilization. It's basic humanist form of solidarity. These are some conclusions, what we can find, what we found, what we think was important, that women who were volunteering in Spain were in clash with their own nations, and many of them upon return were imprisoned, some tortured, some murdered, and some put into permanent exile. So loyalties and brotherhood or sisterhood, relations of sisterhood, are very much contested in this context. Also very much important, and I do not want to dismiss the role of the Communist Party. Communist Party was a very important mobilizing force. It provided resources, it provided information. But it was not the only reason that these women traveled abroad, so it was rather affiliation by situation that was very much important. As I mentioned, this may be a very important move to revive alternative memories that will contest the current narratives of the 20th century and the struggles, ideological struggles of 20th century. And especially we can contest with these biographies and these testimonies theories of nationalism, especially the most famous one by Benedict Anderson, who begins his huge exploration, his great exploration actually into making of the modern nation by claiming that that the sentiment, the national sentiment, comes from the willingness to die for one's nation. And in the same place he says one is not willing to die for a political idea. Spanish volunteers contest that thesis completely. Time is up, yeah. I will just end with the last line. What are the spaces of loyalty today when we are witnessing a crisis again of borders, of solidarity with the subaltern, with people who are vulnerable, who are actually the product of our own wars and product of our own colonialism? I would say that this challenge is very much educational as much as political. So I would argue that it would be very important that we start pedagogical project which would be based on recovering memories that tell a different story of the 20th century. We have become a kind of a victim of a polarization that has been put upon ourselves by political elites, polarization which has convinced us that Europe was divided between East and West, communist East and democracy, etc., etc. But basically, these divisions, as we see now in crisis in Greece and now in refugee crisis, have no real political or ideological basis. Other conflicts, other interests are behind. So it seems to me that memory can be a very important tool in contesting or even struggling against those interests. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Xenia. And then the last but not the least presentation, it will deal with the International Workers' Relief and Willy Münchenberg campaigns, practices and celebrations of transnational solidarity, 1921-1933. And it will be presented by Kasper Braskeen, who comes from Åbo Akademi University, Turku, Finland. And he has just released a book on this topic, so I assume that he will know what he's speaking of. And he has been interested in Münchenberg and his international solidarity campaigns, but he's now turning to a new topic, and he's going to study the origins of anti-fascism, transnational movements against fascism, Nazism, and the white terror in Europe, 1923 to 1939. But they obviously have some problems with Kasper's PowerPoint presentation, so we have to wait for a moment.
My presentation title is The International Workers' Relief and Willy Münchenberg Campaigns, Practices and Celebrations of Transnational Solidarity. So let's begin with the scene. In 1931, the International Workers' Relief organized in Berlin a World Congress celebrating its 10-year-long work as an international solidarity organization. It was a seven-day-long extravaganza which brought together communists, socialists, anti-imperialists, anti-fascists, and sympathizing intellectuals from every corner of the world. They say that the men and women of all races and colors joined the celebrations. Europeans, Chinese, American, Australians, Indians, Negroes, Swedes, Indonesians, Russians, Egyptians, Greeks and Japanese. This 1931 World Congress was perceived to be an unprecedented opportunity for delegates from all around the world to meet and discuss the necessary improvement of international unity. In total, the various IAHA congresses held in Berlin during this 1 week attracted 230 foreign delegates from at least 40 countries. Now, even Georgi Dimitrov, the leader of the Comintern's West European Bureau in Berlin, declared in a secret report back to Moscow that the IAHA celebrations in Berlin had been dazzling. So, under the auspices of the Comintern, the IAHA launched some of the interwar period's most spectacular international solidarity campaigns under the leadership of Münchenberg. Throughout the 1920s and early 1930s, the IAHA articulated a message of radical international solidarity that was never restricted to a European solidarity. Instead, it specifically promoted the idea of international solidarity, which was stretched from west to east and from north to south. As this talk will illustrate, the IAHA's network connected most parts of the world, as IAHA bureaus, either legal or clandestine, were established globally. Most significantly, the IAHA was not only an organization promoting symbolical solidarity, but also an organization of practical solidarity work, which showed to provide food relief during major strikes, lockouts, and natural disasters. Oh, great. In this presentation, I will analyze a selection of the IAHA's campaigns and look at the various practices and celebrations of solidarity. I will argue that IAHA constitutes a significant case study of an early international organization which had unparalleled prospects to develop new transnational and global networks and identifications. However, the IAHA never promoted a kind of universal solidarity that would include everyone, but was conceptualized within the framework of radical international solidarity of the oppressed. So I will not be able to make a kind of comprehensive presentation of all the IAHA solidarity campaigns, because obviously there were so many, but illustrate instead the IAHA's methods to spread its message of radical international solidarity and kind of analyze its ability to awaken solidarity movements in Europe. What was radical international solidarity in practice and theory? And how did the IAHA in Münzenberg define it? Now, firstly, a distinct character of the IAHA's international solidarity work was that it included a strong global imaginary that inspired European, Northern Latin American, Australian, South African, and Chinese workers to start thinking globally. In most cases, the IAHA's international solidarity campaigns were directed against atrocities, oppression, and social misery caused by global forces and powers, such as imperialism, international capitalism, fascism, and extraordinary natural calamities that most often hit the poorest in society the hardest. So most significantly, the IAHA's activities encompassed the turning of seemingly local, regional, or national social conflicts, strikes, or humanitarian crises into global affairs, demanding the response of the workers of the world. Change the slide, it works. Fantastic. However, the international character of the IAHA and its development of global ambitions fits rather badly into the traditional kind of chronology and definitions of international organizations, although it in several ways could be perceived as kind of a predecessor to contemporary NGOs and solidarity networks. So the Comintern, on the other hand, classified the IAHA in 1926 as a part of his system of international organization that functioned as sympathizing mass organization for special purposes. Now, the IAHA's special objective was to function as an international solidarity organization and to spread the idea of international solidarity around the world. However, it was only in a few countries that the IAHA could actually be developed into a so-called mass organization, which leave this definition somewhat wanting. In its publications, the IAHA itself used a number of definitions, including, I quote, a relief organization of the working class, or World Organization of Proletarian Solidarity, or lastly, a non-party mass organization. So secondly, one can argue that the IAHA was deeply engaged in creating a new global culture of international solidarity, which was integrally connected with what Eric D. Weitz calls the greatest transformation of media culture since Johannes Gutenberg. The IAHA was supremely adept at taking advantage of and mastering the new mediums of the mass media, including pictorial newspapers, cinema, and the extensive use of arts and photomontages in its publications. From its inception in 1921, illustrated publications played a key role in the IAHA's ability to both convey and empower its message of international solidarity. So this was the beginning of an unprecedented revolution in illustrated products that would result in the publication of pictorial newspapers and journals such as Soviet Russland im Bild, Sekund Hammer, IZ, Eulenspiegel, and Mahnruf, Organ für Internationale Solidarität. Of course, the majority of the publications were in German, but they also published illustrated brochures, journals, and bulletins in various languages, such as Dutch, French, English, Spanish, Russian, Norwegian, Romanian, Chinese. And in addition to its media coverage, the IAHA was actively engaged in organizing international solidarity events which form the basis of its international solidarity campaign work and its global imaginary. Now, these solidarity events must be perceived as having been crucial in the IAHA's efforts to both energize and give meaning to the idea of radical international solidarity amongst the workers in various countries. These events were always organized in connection with current solidarity campaigns, and included solidarity matinees, congresses, conferences, public lectures, rallies, proletarian movies, and performances by agitprop theater groups, all accompanied by the IAHA's fundraising drives for current solidarity campaigns. So the ability to organize such events was naturally restricted by various circumstances within different countries. In some areas, the IAHA functioned more or less illegally, in others as an openly active public organization. So it was in particular in Germany that the IAHA developed into a notable membership organization. It even developed separate sections for women and youth, and it was engaged in organizing summer camps for orphanages, for workers' children, as well as transporting of German children to neighboring countries during strikes, for example. So the IAHA was in fact involved in forming a whole solidarity experience, one could argue. The IAHA was providing strike aid and support and education during work time. It was involved in family affairs, sexual consultation, child nurturing, and again engaged itself in women's issues, such as fighting against the notorious Section 218, which criminalized abortion in Weimar Germany. It organized activities during leisure time and free time, such as producing proletarian literature through its own publishing house called the Neue Deutsche Verlag, and offered membership to its proletarian book club called the Universum Bücherei. The IAHA also organized, of course, cinema evenings, public meetings, and seminars on the current state of the working class. From 1929, the IAHA organized an annual International Solidarity Day, which offered the opportunity to publicly celebrate international solidarity. And all these events articulated a radical international solidarity of the oppressed, but also promoted an uncritical admiration of the Soviet Union, of Lenin, and of Stalin. So articulating a positive image of the Soviet Union was an important aspect of it all, but as the German communist Clara Zetkin expressed, the IAHA's principal mission was to emphasize to workers, both men and women, the fact that irrespective of their occupation, nationality, race, gender, or religion, they were united by their international class solidarity. It was a unity of destiny, a community tied together by fate that should initiate a united struggle against their oppressors. So one of the most central building blocks of the IAHA solidarity campaigns was the element of spontaneity among the world's workers. Workers were supposedly not only spontaneous in their expressions of solidarity, but also spontaneous in their readiness to sacrifice their own livelihoods in the name of solidarity. So in essence, the heart of this message was presented in such a way that the reciprocity of the campaign was emphasized. If you help Soviet Russia, if you help other workers in distant countries, it was the same as helping yourself. So most significantly, this message of international solidarity emphasized its reciprocal quality. The Russian workers had suffered and bled for years, allegedly unselfishly fighting for the common cause of the international proletariat. And now, in 1921, when the famine hit Soviet Russia, it was the time had come to not only speak of solidarity, but to bring international solidarity life in both Europe and the world to common action of the workers. In a sense, it expressed a conviction that when there was sorrow within the family of the workers, then even the most distant workers would assist to a higher degree than the rich, who would succumb to merely charity or philanthropy. So hence a clear line was drawn between workers' unconditional solidarity on the one hand and capitalist philanthropy on the other. Well, this was an important distinction. And this definition has also a profound meaning for the analysis of the relation between the so-called donors in solidarity campaigns and the receivers in different situations. There is not a notion of hierarchy or otherness in the relationship, but a sense of mutuality and sameness. International solidarity in this form signal a kind of international cooperation between the weak and poor, a transnational unity between the people in equal social status in their own respective countries. So in an appeal signed by Münzenberg in 1921, he expressed that the feeling of solidarity would motivate the whole working class to action once they realized that their brothers, made of the same flesh and blood, were facing a ghastly death, like in 1921 in Soviet Russia. And Münzenberg thereafter articulated one of his main arguments regarding worker solidarity. Irrespective of high, the spontaneous waves of solidarity were among the masses, it would never lead to true success until this spontaneous solidarity was centrally organized and realized. This clearly shows a significant understanding of the limits and possibilities of international relief work, and a realization of the key role played by the intermediary, such as the IHA, that connected the donors and the recipients. Now, this role was clearly not a passive force, but a force that had the ability, or at least a strong ambition, to influence people, to bring about a sort of consciousness, a kind of preparedness to engage themselves for the victims of the famine, or a strike, or whatever the cause might be. Anyone who was kind of in need of solidarity. Yeah. Now, as an example, I could take from the campaign 1921-22, this story from Hamburg of a party functionary called Gustav Gundalach. So many years later, he remembered in unpublished typescript how they organized the workers' relief in his local quarters in Hamburg. So they made a room in the apartment available for women to come and sew clothes for the Russian starving. And Gundalach then recalls that one day, when the Russian comrade, Käthe Paul, visited Hamburg and saw the ready piles of children's and baby clothes. According to Gundalach, tears had rolled down her cheeks as she had emotionally clasped their hands and warmly exclaimed how the mothers in St. Petersburg would be filled with joy at the sight of these packages. Was this perhaps the heart and essence of the practical workers' international solidarity, which for so long has been lost in a sense? To express one's solidarity in practical terms to others suffering misery seems to be an essential aspect of international solidarity, which is hereby brought back into the fold of historical analysis. Kind of the human aspect, expressed by a passionate feeling of doing a good deed for other people suffering misery, and the subsequent emotional commitment that these deeds entail. These must be included as a central part of this kind of spectrum of solidarity and the analysis of organizations for international solidarity, such as the IHA. So, especially women's contributions to the IHA's practical solidarity work, as shown in some of these pictures and here as well, was a very central one. And in these kind of contexts also, solidarity was described as a kind of a dormant feeling of solidarity within the proletariat. Meaning that, but solidarity was something that was innate part of every worker. it was there. It just needed someone to awaken it, to activate it, to bring it to life. So solidarity is not only something that is created through struggle, but also defined as a kind of a slumbering, ever-present force within the self. And this was kind of the core mission of the IAHA throughout the period, to turn international solidarity into an active force wherever and whenever it was needed. So there are a range of kind of these stories of emotionally loaded narratives of giving to others and helping, for example, children in need during strikes and so on. But due to lack of time, I will skip some parts of this and instead focus on kind of the relation of this international solidarity also with kind of the globalization of international solidarity through the IAHA. So until 1924, the IAHA was very much focused on one campaign at a time. But after December 24, the Orgbüro of the Executive Committee of the Comintern gave the IAHA the mandate to organize solidarity campaigns in, for example, China, in Japan, and the colonial countries, where the masses had not yet reached class consciousness. So the IAHA's mission was to convince the masses in the colonial countries that the workers in Europe and America did not support their imperialist masters. So according to directives from the Comintern, it was of utmost importance to prove that bonds of solidarity did not exist between Europeans or Americans in general, but that the Western working class and its oppressed peoples in the colonial countries were natural allies. And this was kind of the prehistory of making anti-imperialism, anti-colonialism a central part of the IAHA that then was kind of taken over by the League Against Imperialism. But though throughout the period, anti-imperialism, anti-fascism, anti-colonialism was kind of merged in the IAHA solidarity campaigns, as you can see from the last picture as well. So, in conclusion, I have tried to show that in order to drum up support among the workers of the world, the IAHA utilized and developed a number of innovative means and methods for its campaign work, including the active use of emotionally loaded language, art, photos, and films, and mass media. So in this sense, the international famine relief to Soviet Russia, So, in conclusion, these kind of inspiring actions which were either reported on, that others were doing, or the kind of encouragement that you should do them as well, were kind of essential for the IAHA solidarity articulations throughout the period. So in the end, the activities of the IAHA contributed to the creation of a very broad culture of international solidarity that included most aspects of life and formed an important but often kind of neglected contribution to the emerging transnational and global civil society of the 20th century. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kasper. Now we have heard all the presentations and it's time for comments. And they will be presented by Gert Rainer Horn, who is a professor of political history at Sciences Po in Paris. And his interests include various social movements, not only labor movement, but also this left Catholicism. But it seems to me that he has also been interested in certain moments of liberations or moments of enthusiasm. And the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much. I will try to bring you a moment of enthusiasm here. Since I only have 600 seconds for my commentary, I will dispense with the idea of trying to make grand connections between. It's all possible, but I prefer, having only 580 seconds left, to give some comments on the specific papers, which I think is more useful, certainly for the paper givers, perhaps, than anything else. So, for lack of any grander plan, I will do it in the sequence in which the papers were presented. So I will start with the paper on the Danish Social Democratic Youth Organization and the relationships to the international, the Socialist Youth International, let me call it, paper by Jesper Jorgensen and Gerd Kallesen, I guess it's a co-production. I think it's fair enough to say, and this is not meant as a criticism really, that the paper is more about the Socialist Youth International in certain ways than about the Danish section of the Youth International. I mean, there's elements of both, but I think in some ways, I didn't do a lexicological study of how many paragraphs, the one or the other. It's obviously connected, the paper is about the connection, but I think that the Danish section is in some respects secondary. Nonetheless, let me mention a couple of questions I have on the pure Danish connection. You mentioned that the non-Copenhagen members broke with the radical pro-communist members based more or less around Copenhagen, if I remember the paper right. And I'm curious, I'm really curious why that is. I mean, because it is not necessarily always a hard and fast rule that big cities, or especially capital cities, are the most radical. I mean, oftentimes it is, but not always. And I don't know, I'm happily innocent about deep knowledge of Danish history, so, that's one of the questions that I have. For me, coming to all this from a transnational perspective myself, the most interesting aspect of the paper to me was the reconstruction of these transnational networks that were going on at a time which was a most difficult time to do any kind of networking, certainly transnational networking in World War I. And here, of course, and you don't necessarily underscore it, it's maybe modesty or whatever, but the role of the Scandinavians in general, and Denmark maybe in particular, but not just Denmark, was probably quite crucial, as they were less affected by the war. They could play a coordinating role, which gave them an importance out of all proportion. That youth groups as such are often the radical edge of already quite radical movements is, of course, in a sense, a truism. Let me only suggest that the next test for the Socialist Youth International emerged about 15 years later in the mid-1930s in the wake of a radicalization of the Labor and Socialist International when in 1934, through the early 1935, it almost came to an open split and the establishment of a rival international youth federation, a split within the Socialist Youth International, a rival organization which would have been, had it really been created, close to the London Bureau, an organization called the Amicale de Toulouse, which included mostly Southern European organizations. So the theme of youth radicalization, of course, is really a universal one in a certain way. I better go on to the next paper because of time constraints. The paper on the Tolstoyan piece, well, whatever the term is, I found very interesting. This melange of radical pacifism, Christian socialism, and anarchism is something that I can rather interested in, at least intellectually. Certainly, the link between anarchism and Christianity is, in the 20th century, not necessarily that self-evident for most people. Most church historians would not really look at the anarchist movement as a topic for, let's say, dissertations or so. They're wrong, I think, but so it's very interesting to have this happen. And the other term, of course, you mentioned is the term Christian communism. And you focus on the international links, you know, the Fellowship of Reconciliation, etc. And you mentioned the 1926 Oberammergau meeting to found an international movement for Christian communism, which is, of course, very interesting. Now, anybody who knows a little bit about Oberammergau wouldn't normally pick that one, that location, as a likely location for a Christian communist movement. But, and I'm not quite sure what actually happened to this movement. I get an impression maybe it was stillborn, but I'm curious about that. What I'm also curious more generally is how many members and sympathizers may have been in the Tolstoyan movement at that time. Another question I have is, you know, I'm curious if there were any ex-Bolsheviks or ex-Mensheviks or maybe more so ex-left social revolutionaries involved in that movement. And I also, I presume that Willy Münzenberg himself never really dealt with that grouping. We didn't mention him, but that's probably the rationale. Moving on to, well, Lausanne, but okay, Moscow. 10th anniversary of the October Revolution. I actually wonder, you know, to put it in perspective, it would have been interesting to see, I have no clue, if there were 9th anniversary celebrations, 8th, 7th, 6th, you know, probably not, I don't know. At any rate, the 10th one is obviously a big one. And, well, what's particularly interesting is because it was that moment of turning point in the relationship to the repression of the opposition in the Soviet Union and internationally. So that, of course, piqued my interest in many ways. Some questions that arose for me is that you mentioned the huge meetings that took place in other countries. I mean, you know, Berlin, Hamburg, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm curious, were there any non-communists involved in a serious way in those celebrations? I mean, was there more of an effort to establish a serious united front or proto-united front? You know, I know they had this kind of key of whatever, 40% social democrats, blah, 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 for Moscow, but that probably didn't mean all that much in Moscow. So I'm curious how it meant, how it was in the other places. Amongst the foreign delegates in Moscow, the many foreign delegates who went there, I'm just curious if there are any reminiscences about the event by some of them written in the weeks, months, years later that would have been interesting to look at. In the footnotes, I didn't see very many references, but okay, one can only do so many things. An interesting footnote, actually, which you didn't, I'm benefiting from the written version, that you didn't get to hear is that it's not completely clear the context, but apparently, you know, workers, bona fide blue-collar workers, I guess, traveled to Moscow third class. Intellectuals, certainly some of them, you mentioned the one case where intellectuals from South America traveled by in the first class cabin across the Atlantic. Now, I find that interesting. This says a lot. It's just, you know, sort of hidden in the footnote, but I wonder, you know, was this a general thing? I mean, even people not from South America, you know, was it the same kind of strange kind of, you know, introduction of class division? And how was that in maybe earlier meetings that took place in Moscow at earlier years at this time? Well, let me, I have one, two more, but okay, whoops, well, I'll pick it up later. The paper on the Yugoslav volunteers. Mention one. Well, to me, a central sentence really in that is the one on page 14. The gender dimensions of volunteering are complex and have not been adequately researched. You cite from an author, which is absolutely correct. Indeed, I totally agree. The only thing is that I do, by pure chance, knowing a little bit about the Spanish, even female, foreign visitors and participants, I think there's actually more than is suggested in the footnotes, etc., which are ample, you know, that's not the problem. There isn't all that much. It's worth exploring as a real topic, but there are more things there than is sometimes suggested. That's okay, I can give you some ideas, but you know, not here, because I'm actually out of time. There is a paper in the tendency, there's a tendency in the paper to ascribe to itself a more innovative and path-breaking methodology or methodological breakthrough than is, in my view, warranted. I don't think that the alternative memory of the past that you invoke is something entirely new, necessarily requiring a revival. I mean, yes, the kinds of approaches that maybe all of us have to these kind of topics is not necessarily the mainstream in history, sociology, et cetera, departments, but there is quite a bit going on for some time in this area. So I'm slightly skeptical about the claim for methodological innovation. And I have to say, just as my own personal thing, that the meaning and the message of this contribution is also not necessarily aided by the recourse to postmodern idiom. Now, I had the benefit of having the whole entire text, and I'll spare you some citations, but you know, there, I'm not so sure if the methodological parts really clarify the cause or the issues behind the Yugoslav volunteers, female volunteers in Spain. And now I come to the last paper. I apologize for being already in 700 seconds here. Well, you know, it's one, I'm German, you know, so I want to be precise, so. You say, if the first condition for promoting the idea of radical international solidarity was the actual establishment of a global network, the second stage was to utilize this network in order to produce a global imaginary based on international solidarity. And that sentence to me is really key in terms of your project, in terms of what you presented. And I guess part of another way of saying what you are saying, which is maybe not what the kind of word that you would choose or the example, but to me always Münzenberg was the Rupert Murdoch of the Comintern. It's very clear, in more ways than one, unfortunately. Networking and the establishment of a global imaginary based on international solidarity, that was his mission in life, you know. Okay, not Murdoch's, but Münzenberg's. It's just the methods and the innovation, really. There are many, it would be an interesting paper to compare the two. I mean, coming from totally different corners, politically. Now, the paper is in some respects, formally, the most well-constructed of the five panel contributions. I mean, it's all relative, you know. But it also tries to do, in some ways, too many things with too little space. So I'm looking forward to the book, which, of course, you know, is it's difficult to compress a book into, you know, 20 minutes or so. Last comment. Obviously, it's clear, I'm repeating the obvious, the International Workers' Relief relied on Münzenberg's media and propaganda skills in a massive way. And I sometimes wonder what could have happened, what would have happened, if the most innovative and imaginative minds of the European left in the interwar time period, who were divided amongst themselves, amongst different mutually antagonistic political groupings, if they would have joined forces in certainly the late 20s and then throughout the 30s. Who am I thinking of? Obviously, Willy Münzenberg is the classic, and for obvious reasons, you know, he is the first one to be mentioned. But let me just mention two others, just because I don't want to overrun more. Someone who probably, those of you who know him, will not like him, but to me he was one of the most brilliant minds and imaginative in various ways, is the Flemish social democrat Hendrik de Man, who is, I mean, I'm talking about Hendrik de Man up to 1934-35, in his Pleinist ideas, the propaganda methods he developed, amazingly interesting, very innovative, and very much along the lines of, in a sense, what Münzenberg was doing, more or less at the same time, although, of course, at that time, the two divided brothers were not necessarily talking to each other. And the third one I want to mention just briefly is, well, an ex-Menshevik, Sergei Chakhotin, who is probably less known for most people, but he developed in the closing months, literally, or year or two of the Weimar Republic, some very, very innovative propaganda techniques in the Hessen region in various propaganda campaigns of the Iron Front and the SPD that had a lot of things in common with what Hendrik de Man and Willy Münzenberg were doing. And that's all I'm going to say, and I apologize for running over. So thank you very much.
I think you can make the questions later on personally to the panelists. But I think it's time for us to upload for the panelists at the moment.